Bom, boa tarde a todos e a todas. Eu vou apresentar o Mohamed Kabeesi. Essa conversa vai ser em inglês, e depois a gente vai colocar subtítulos em português e disponibilizar nas nossas mídias sociais e na página do YouTube da Stand With Us. Mohamed, hi. Thank you
Hey,
for joining us. Thank you for
it's
being
my
with
pleasure.
us. I'm going to introduce you. Mohamed Kabeesi is an Israeli Bedouin who served in the IDF on a search and rescue team in the Israeli Air Force. Raised in the village of Kabia, which was named after his family, Mohammed comes from a long line of Bedouins who have supported Israel. After finishing his service in the IDF, Mohammed continued his work on behalf of Israel, becoming an IDF consultant and pro-Israel activist. And if I'm not mistaken, he also worked for the Prime Minister. For the
Yeah,
former.
I worked for the Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu.
Yeah, for the former. It's
Yeah, the
not, we
former.
are not usual to say former, but he's former.
It's former, and I think that he will come back.
Come back. Yeah, we're going
Yeah.
to talk about that. Mohammed, thank you again. I think you know Stand With Us quite well from Israel, right? Michael Dixon and all our friends
Yeah.
from.
Yeah, my beginnings was with the Stand With Us in Israel.
Yes. Can you tell me a little bit about how different you feel or how similar you feel? Because many people outside of Israel think that the Arab population of Israel are suffering from racism and from other kinds of hatred. And of course, they don't know that many Arabs and many Bedouins and many Druze, Christians, Muslims, serve in IDF. And I think that you could start for the story of your family. Maybe if you can tell us about the past of the village, of the family, the name of the family and the village, and about the beginning of your life, maybe.
I think that one of the big mistakes of the international media in the world is that they never exposed the reality and the facts about the Arabs and the minorities in Israel. And I think that the great example for that is my unique story, or my unique family story. That began many time ago in 1936, before the State of Israel created. My great-grandfather was live in he lived in Emek Israel Valley. And his neighbor was a Jewish person, but not a simple Jewish person, because he was Alexander Zaid. Alexander Zaid was the head of the Shomer movement, and the first security movement in Israel and before the IDF and the Protector movement. And one day, Arab insurgents schemed to kill Alexander Zaid, and his Bedouin friend, the Sheikh, heard about the schemes and decided to protect them. And when the insurgents came to kill them, he gave the family of Zaid a shield and defended them and attacked the insurgents. And after that, when the IDF created was the first minority group with the Druze that joined it to the IDF was the Bedouins here in Israel. And we have 350,000 Bedouins in Israel. The bigger part is in the south, 250,000, and the second part is in the north, is 100,000, And yes, because that it wasn't for a question for me when I been in 18 old, in 18 years old, if I have to serve in the IDF or not, because it was very normal and it felt like a duty to serve in the Israeli Defense Forces. And yes, I went to the army. I served in the Israeli Air Force and help and rescue unit. And
is the 6669?
Is the squadron that flood them, not the fighting them, is not the unit, but we served with all special units in the IDF, and after an amazing 4 years in the army, I left my service and I became a consultant for the Israeli government, and in the last year, I had the pleasure to be a strategic consultant for the former Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. And
can I ask you on which field you consulted for Prime Minister?
It's I very proudly that I did that. Because you know, you work with, in my eyes, one is the smartest and the biggest leader in the world. This is what I felt and what I'm feeling, because Benjamin Netanyahu did a lot things for the state of Israel, and who's lived here and who's living here and know what our country is struggling every day, and which things that we have to deal with it every day and every hour. You will know what is meaning to be the Prime Minister of Israel. And then, and what under which pressure you will be that you have to deal with all the world. And when I say with all the world, I mean that because you have to protect your country from two organizations that surrounded Israel. You have to fight for your country and diplomacy in the world and in Europe and in the States and in the rest of the world, and you have daily to do everything that you will promise that your country will still here strong and can deal with the all enemies and with the all dangers and I will say it in Hebrew and you will help me. Etgarim.
Challenges,
sorry. And with all challenges. And yes, I think that I learned and studied a lot from him, and I think that is amazing experience.
I can believe that. And and so one of the big challenges that we as an organization have here in Brazil, and Standiverse has globally, and not just Standiverse, other organizations, is to fight against the new anti-Semitism, which is anti-Zionism. And it's a very special and unique challenge, because there are people from within that sometimes tend to not just criticize Israel, which is legitimate, but also to delegitimize Israel, right to exist or right to defend itself. And I saw a couple of videos of you in the campuses in the United States, where you talk to students, and so many of them like very anti-Israel. And one of them particularly, I remember, you spoke in Hebrew.
Because he was Israeli student.
What happened?
And they annoyed me so much because I heard them that he spoke against Israel in the Columbia campus in the States. And it made me so angry because what he said or spoke as it was a false. I told them that you have only one country in the world and you should to protect this country, because if you haven't this country, that all the world will harm you and will they do anything to harm you, and this country is the only thing that protects you. And this is what I'm feeling like as an Arab Muslim here, as a minority in Israel. And when I hearing Israelis, especially from the leftist extreme organizations that speaking against Israel is, and especially false things, is it's make me so angry and so annoying because the many of people in the world, many racist people and extremist people that hearing these things and believe for these things, and this false information, they will use it against us, against the Israelis and against the Israeli students that study thing around the world. I'm living in Israel. I have a grateful life in Israel as a minority, as an Israeli Arab. And how I said before, I worked for the prime minister and I was very close to him. And I every day I met them and I worked with them and I were with them in everywhere. And we have equal rights and we have anything. And I think that nothing keep a Bedouin that don't have to volunteer to the IDF to do that if he wasn't feeling that he is a part, integral part from Israel. Because that is so annoying to hear people, especially Jewish people, to speak against Israel around the world and in campuses, because the BDS activists, they don't know anything about Israel. They don't know anything about the facts on the ground about the minorities in Israel. They what they know is what their leaders, like Omar Barghouti, who got a MA from Israeli University, and he lived here in Israel with his wife, is an Arab-Israeli woman, and they have the Israeli citizenship, and he had a grateful life here. He shared a false information, and he did a false campaign against Israel. It's just for economy interests or agenda, and to get more and more money. And this, the symbol, the simple activists in the campus, he don't know anything about Israel, and he only saying what he heard about these leaders. And I think that they are victims for the SGP or BDS leadership, because they're using them only for their agenda and only for to get more and more donations and monies. And this is the, I think that the absurd thing that I can see. And I have to share with you example about what happened with me in one of the campuses in the States. One day, I was in one of the campuses in California, and I saw Mexican student girl walking in a journal with walking with a protester that they called from the river to the sea, Palestine will be free. And I was, it was very strange to me to see a Mexican girl with a student that saying that.
First time? And
what?
What, the first time? The first time you saw it?
Yeah, the first time I saw it in live, in reality. Okay. And after that, I had a lecture in the same campus, and I saw the same student in my lecture. And I did something like that. I said in the middle of my lecture, I want to say, I want to do something like that. Now I will point to student here in the class, and I want to ask her one question. If she will answer me a correct answer, I will move to the other side, to the BDS side. And all of the students there, they look to me like, what are you doing? And I pointed to this student, and I asked her, I saw you with the students outside early today, walking with the protesters, and you said you called from the river to the sea, Palestine will be free. Can you tell me, please, which river and which sea they spoke about? And she didn't have an answer to me. And I told them, this is the reality about the BDS. They don't know anything. They only saying sentences, slogan. That slogans that their leadership teaching them.
Exactly. This is the big challenge we have this in the 21st century, which is the HRA definition of anti-Semitism, the International Holocaust Remember Alliance, which is, if you criticize Israel in the same manner you criticize other countries, it's okay. It's legitimate, it's good even for democracy, you have to criticize. But if you criticize with demonization words, if you compare Israel to the Nazi Germany, if you call the IDF to behave to the Palestinians as the Nazi behaved to the Jews and stuff like that, this is anti-Semitism.
And I have to say something about the IDF. All my life until my military service, I heard about how much the IDF is a humanitarian army. But I really knew that just only when I served in the IDF, because many times we had this emergency siren and the staff of combats and pilots was departing to anywhere to help people. And many times this people was a Palestinian people. That children from Gaza Strip, that the hospitals there couldn't give them medical aid, or Syrian civilians that injured in the civil war there, or some Palestinians that had injured in the borders or something like that. And many times we found ourselves helping a Palestinian people. And I always say that the times that the IDF helped and gave the Palestinian people aid is hundreds times more than the Hamas did that, or the other Palestinian organizations did that. And in the same time when the Hamas using the Palestinian people as a human shield, in Israel building hospitals on the borders to help the Palestinian people that injured in the war. As I can't believe or know how these organizations can compare between the IDF and between between anti-Semitism organizations, or between the IDF or between and the Nazis, because you don't have what to compare. If you want to compare the IDF, you have to compare it with the aid organizations of the UN. I think that because the IDF not only defend our country, is also help the Palestinian and help anyone that needed the help.
Yes, and this is the big, this is a problem that we face, because people don't get the reality in Israel. And of course, they if reality is brought to them, they will reject reality. So those that are against Israel will reject that reality in order to fit the narrative into the story they are telling, so they can convince people. Some people, for example, go further and say that Israel actually is not a democracy, or is an ethno-democracy, or they accuse that the fact that the Jews have some privilege over the Arabs in Israel. They mention even Aliyah, which is the returning law to the law of return that was based in the Holocaust. As an Arab, how would you answer that? As an Arab, as a Zionist Arab, as an Israeli Arab, former IDF.
Israeli Arab.
Yeah.
First of all, I don't know if they know that we have two Arab-Israeli ministers and many high officers in the army and the police, they are Arabs. And you can find Arabs or minorities in every system in Israel, in the education system, in the government system, in the army system, in the defense system, and anywhere. Diplomats, in the courts, and everywhere you can find the Arabs. And I give them a great example about that the judge that judged the Israeli president to 7 years in the jail was an Arab, Christian Arab. Yeah. And we have many others that really they got to be in I call it a K places in the Israeli system. And we here in Israel, we nobody limits you to do what you want and what you need. And you have the freedom to do anything, and only don't harm other people, and not don't pass the rules, and that's it. You can do anything, and I like a minority I had in my studies in the university. I have a scholarship that is special scholarship for the minorities to support them and to promote them to go to and to study in the universities. That the Jewish people they don't get this scholarships. And the last thing that we can say about Israel that is a not democracy, because we have here over democracy.
Over
democracy, yeah, and especially for the Arabs.
Let me ask you something. Let's get into maybe a little bit of politics now, of the politics that we can talk.
Okay.
If you allow me, a couple of months ago, I saw an old video from an Arab-Israeli journalist, Khaled Abu Tomeh, from the Jerusalem Post. saying about the, you know him probably.
Yeah, it's a good he person.
Very good person. Very he was prized already in the past. Very good journalist. He said about he was in an event in the U.S. and he said that the Palestinian leadership is in prison, and the prison it's its own rhetoric. They are in jail in its own rhetoric, and they cannot move from the rhetoric because, for example, saying that they want peace with Israel in the Palestinian territories, it's very, 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 very unpopular, because at the same time they sell hate throughout the media, the mosques, the schools, and stuff like that. So they cannot say in the same time they are against Israel or Israel has no right to exist, that they want peace with Israel. My question to you, and not asking about Hamas and Gaza, I'm asking you about the Palestinian Authority, that is the government that the world say that is a partner for peace. Do you think they are a partner for peace?
First of all, I agree with Khaled Abu Toomey 100%, because this is what happening, and what's happening nowadays with the other Arab countries. When Israel is speaking about the normalization with Arab countries, and countries that the first challenge that faced the leadership in these countries is how we can give this peace to our people. How now we can tell our people that Israel is not enemy. Israel is a partner, and Israel is a technology and defend and security and economic partner. And because that we have now a few peace accords that letting, because causes, because you know the many people, many leadership, they knew that Israel is not enemy. Israel can be partner, especially when we have a mutual enemy like Iran, that they really want to destroy Israel and the other countries in the Middle East, especially the Sunnis countries in the Middle East, and we want to control and we want to occupying the Arab countries here in the Middle East, to harm and to attack Israel from these countries. And they are already succeeded to do that with the four countries, is Lebanon, Syria, and Yemen, and from Gaza Strip. Now, after a 73 years old of conflict and with of incitement and the hate and calling by the Palestinian PLO authority against Israel, they will have a big challenge how to bring this peace to their people. Because the first thing that the people will ask, this is the same Israel that you many years incite us against them. Is the same Israel that all the years you call to hate them and to do a tour activists against them. This is the same Israel that you and the mosques, some of the sheikhs in the mosque and the imams, they said we have to stop and to kill Jewish people or Israelis. Then they will have, you know, many problems how to do the normalization with Israel. And I think that they, first of all, have to do normalization inside their territories about how to see Israel, and after that to come and to say and to do a peace accords or agreements with Israel. Another thing that the Palestinian people, they always thought that the Arab world have to walk and to go after them, follow them. And if the Palestinians don't have a peace agreement with Israel, the rest of the Arab world, they have to wait or have to be as a enemies of Israel. And after that, after we resolve the conflict, the Palestinians, they can do a peace agreement. And this is the belief of the beliefs of Benjamin Netanyahu and other leaders in the Middle East, like MBZ or like the leaders of the Bahrain or Morocco and Sudan. Their beliefs that we have to work or to activate for our people, we have to do peace because we can't wait to the Palestinian for never ever, and we have to do a peace. And when we did a peace with the UAE and with Bahrain, especially with these two countries and Morocco, we see how much of economy, mutual economy, and the mutual project we can do together. And I think that the Palestinians they began to understand that no one will still waiting to them, and they will come, and they will ask to begin or to start of negotiation. Exactly. And I wish that this day will come. First of all, we have to know that the safety of Israel and the security of Israel is really promised, and after that we can speak about peace.
Yeah, I there is a lot of issues, right, regarding the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, and after they get into the negotiation table. And I have to ask you two questions. I don't know if you are familiar, but I would like to have your opinion because of your experience or because of your heritage. First of all, there is a propaganda from some parts of the Arab sector in East Jerusalem and the Palestinians that the Jews want to destroy the Al-Aqsa Mosque, or that the Jews want to rebuild the temple, which I believe that there are some Jews that want to rebuild the temple. I don't know, maybe 1,000 people or maybe less. But this is not the state of Israel. This is not an official position. And this is not a lot of people, of course. And also there is a prohibition to pray inside of the Temple Mount, which is the same place as the Al-Aqsa Mosque compound, the Haram al-Sharif. And I don't see, as a political scientist, a solution for the conflict without resolving this issue because of this particular space, because it's holy to Islam, but it's holy to the Jews. And I would like to ask you, as a Muslim, can you explain a little bit for us why there is so many problems, if in the past 50 years ago, 60 years ago was not a problem to pray there, right? And it's the same God in the end of the day. And if you think that they are using that in order to avoid peace, maybe.
First of all, by the Jewish Orthodox position is, and this is the officially opposition of the State of Israel, is that the Jewish people can't worship or praying on the Temple Mount. I heard about that we have a Jewish people that we want to build the they want to destroy the Al-Aqsa Mosque.
The Al-Aqsa Mosque.
Yeah, and it's I think that it's maybe tens or maximum hundreds of Jewish people, but the majority of in Israel here, they respect the all religious, and we have the status quo, and the position of the Israeli, the official government here is to save the status quo. And I believe that everyone have to respect the religion of the others, and we have to respect the religion of the Jewish people, and they have to respect the Islam. And I think that is what the situation here in Israel, that we respecting each other. But you have, like in anywhere, extremist people that using the religion for their agenda. Like if they have a chaos on the Temple Mount, it will serve their agenda from the both sides. And I think that we have, and this is what the government in Israel here doing, we have to save, and we have to protect the all religion places, or the all holy places for the all people here. And we have to not let these people, extremist people, to affect on our life. And Israel, I think, is the safely holy places in the world, and especially in the Middle East, because we saw what happened a few kilometers from here, from Israel, in Syria and in Iraq and in other places in the Middle East, that the mosques and the churches and they destroyed because this person, or because this mosque is including some a group of the Islam, or some group of the Christian people. And I think that really that is the most safely place to the holy places is here in Israel.
Yeah, I believe I agree with you. The religious prohibition is well known, but the number of the people visiting from Israeli Jews is growing in the last 5 years, and I really don't see the problem of visiting a holy place. Like, it's just visiting a holy place. They are not trying to destroy
anyone can visit in my position is anyone can visit any holy place, but he have to respect it, and that's it.
To finish, I would like to ask you something. I want to ask you to advise the people that are going to watch us and are watching us now. Many people in Brazil, many supporters of Israel, many people that are pro human rights, pro minority rights, and all the rights from basic human standards, they always feel that they don't know how to answer sometimes to accusations that Israel is a genocidal country, Israel is an apartheid country, Israel committed many mass massacres in the past, that Israel did ethnic cleansing of Arabs, Palestinians from the land in 48. So I would like to ask you, if do you have an answer? Like, would you like to, how do you address those that are pro BDS in Brazil, those that are pro the destruction of the state as the Jewish state? What would you say to them, and how would you advise for somebody that is facing these kind of questions in campuses or in the internet, how they need to answer to that?
Just to check it in Google, and you have the all information Just Google it. You have the all stories about the Israelis like me and like many Arab Israelis that support Israel, and they're sharing their stories as a citizen here in Israel. And I'm an example, and we have thousands of other examples here in Israel. And just to write in Google Arabs in Israel, and you will find members of the Knesset, articles about members of the Knesset, about soldiers, Arab soldiers, and many other articles. And what I have to say that we here in Israel have the freedom to do anything. Really, you can hear or read a great successful stories about Arabs here in Israel that they passed and they did all their way to the highest places in the Israeli system, just to check the facts, it's so easy, that's it. The facts on the ground is very different of what the BDS or SGP or other people they trying to expose. Before you answer any answer about something that you don't know or don't have any idea about it, I offer to you to check it, and you can ask your Israeli friends if you have, and you will find the correct answer. And I have to say something that if we compare Israel and the minorities here in Israel to other minorities in the world, especially the Middle East, and I don't want to compare the minorities to the Middle East. I want to compare it to the minorities in Europe countries. We will find that the minorities here living a grateful life, and we have equal rights like the Jewish people. And if we see what happening to the Jewish people or other minorities in Europe with the new anti-Semitism there, or neo-Nazists, we will find that the Arabs here are living 10 times or 100 times better than the Jewish people there, and not only the Arab Israeli, also the Palestinians that living in the territories. I heard from many of them that their dreams is to come and to work in Israel and to get the all rules, the all rights that the Arabs or the Jewish people or the Israeli citizens they get from the government here.
Yeah, it's true. It's a sad truth. We would like to have a better Europe in the end of the day. No neo-Nazis, yeah. No extreme left, no Islamic jihadists all over, you know. Now there are news today that the Jordanian army avoided an ISIS attack in the border today. Mm-hmm. Jailed a couple of people that wanted to shoot Jordanian soldiers in order to get to the Israeli border, and they were arrested by the Jordanians. So thank God there is some exchange of intel that went from Israel to the Jordanians in order to take them out. But yes, it's true. It's a difficult region. So we don't even compare to the region. We compare to Europe, because the standard needs to be, of course, Israel. The standard is not Syria. The standard is Switzerland. So,
exactly.
Yeah. So this is a very important also. And I believe that probably the some minorities in Switzerland are very discriminated against. And Mohammed, our time is out, but I'd like to thank you again for your time.
We had
just 1 hour. This is also the agreement with the people that work for us, subtitling the because it's a lot of work to put subtitles in Portuguese. I would like to ask you again, if we can make a new interview in the future. We maybe make a joint interview with two or three more people, maybe in Hebrew we can do, and then we translate from Hebrew. We can record that. It will be much easier for everyone to speak the mother tongue. I will be also more usual to speak in Hebrew than in English. So thank you again. Thank you for your service in the Israeli Air Force. We are both reservists from the Israeli Air Force, so we are suspect to say it's the best in the world. So thank you again.
Exactly. Thank you so much. It's my pleasure, and feel free anytime for you and for the thoughts about Israel.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.